That book is very strange. It is still a bestseller worldwide. It is now in 29 languages. I think it's going to hit 7 million sales this year. It was at 6 middle of last year. And although, you know, it was written before internet, before mobile phones, before the Berlin Wall went down and all this sort of stuff, it's horrible how pertinent it is to today's world. And it's extraordinary how pertinent it is to managing a hospital, managing an IT firm, managing whatever. The story is of a factory producing engines. But it is fantastically generic, and for those that know things like DevOps movement and these sorts of things, it's recommended reading in many, many areas. The people in around lean manufacturing consider it a lean manufacturing book, and so forth. The theory of constraints and the basic underlying idea is quite simple. It is that when you have something to do, an organization has a job to do, whatever it is, whether it's producing something or developing a product or whatever, it expects to distribute the work across its organization equitably, right? For instance, that's what we do in an annual budget. We say that in that department we're going to have 17 people because we've calculated that's about how many we need. Over there we're going to have 25 people because 30 people is too much and 20 is not enough, and so forth, right? And when we do that at the end, we're signing a piece of paper that says we have distributed the work equitably throughout our organization. Oh. That's what managers are paid to do, right? If somebody put 40 people when 20 would be enough, he would get fired or told off, right? If somebody only put 6 when they needed 20 and it became a big problem because they didn't have enough capacity, that would also be a problem, right? So annual budgets, for instance, are based on the idea that you are capable of distributing the work evenly throughout your organization. Okay? And once you've done that, it makes management a lot easier because everybody has their work to do, right? So everybody should work all the time, shouldn't they? Right? If there are 20 people there and I said they needed 20, if they stop working, it's going to be a problem for my company. Okay? And Eliyahu Goldratt said that is all garbage. We can't do it, and certainly we can't do it anymore. Maybe at the days of beginning of the 1900s, right, when Baton Rouge making the Model T Ford and stuff, where the products stayed on the market in a very standard form for many years, and you could design a factory to make a product, okay, then you maybe could get some fairly reasonable distribution of capacities, okay. But in today's world, what's happening? Of course, I won't go into the obvious reasons we all know about why the world is changing faster and faster with new products, new competitors, macroeconomics, Trumpism or whatever. Right? The outside demand, what in quantity and in product mix and in technology and so forth, is just getting faster and faster, right? And yet, our capacities, potential we have to install the capacities and the capabilities in a company to do that haven't changed that much. It still takes about the same amount of time to design and build a new process, to hire a new capable person and train them. You know, we're talking about months, years, according to how technical the subject is, right? So it's going to take you 6 months or maybe 6 years to increase or change a capacity in your organization. And yet the market, the demand, what you're being asked to do, is moving faster and faster, right? So what he said many, many years ago, 30 years ago now, was already fairly true. And now, as far as I'm concerned, it's evidently true everywhere. When I started talking about theory of constraints 25 years ago, we had to convince people that they had bottlenecks and that things were unbalanced. We don't hardly have to do that anymore. People come to us and say, we've got a bottleneck here. Okay? And that's not only, to my mind, fairly normal. It is just going to get worse and worse and worse. And to my mind, the theory of constraints is just growing in pertinence from year to year because we are no longer capable of distributing the work equitably so that everybody has just the right amount of work. Okay? That's the basic idea, to face up to the fact that you cannot any longer distribute the work evenly throughout your organization And therefore, in that distribution, somebody's got short straw, la courte paille, somebody's got more work than everybody else. Okay? And that's all the theory of constraints is about, is recognizing that, adapting your rules, your management, culture to that idea. Okay? So, it shows I've just been doing this for a long time. The company logo is meant to summarize that idea. Okay, if we have whatever your work is, whether it's a hospital or new products or making cars or whatever, okay, and that's where you start and that's where you finish, okay, that capacity will be determined by the size of your pipe, okay, and in reality, there is always somewhere in the system, some part of the system has less capacity than its neighbors, and that is the constraint, that is the bottleneck. That's the simple thing about it, okay. Once you've recognize that, obviously you better find this spot because if this thing stops for a day, that's an hour lost of sales for the company, or a day lost for the company, right? If this thing has a one-day problem, it'll catch up. Okay, if this has a one-day problem, it'll catch up. If you lose an hour on your constraint, you can never catch it. It's not gone forever. Okay, so an hour lost at a constraint is an hour lost for the entire system, and just as difficult to realize, an hour gained at a non-constraint has no value whatsoever. If somebody comes to you with a new project, says, I have a new machine that could increase the capacity here by 30%, what's the point? Okay, so as you'll see as the day goes through, it's kind of disturbing because it does mean that about 8 times out of 10, people are proposing to improve a non-constraint, zero value. When people talk about, you know, I have so many improvement projects in my company, I need to manage the portfolio of our improvement projects. Sure. But first thing, by the way, 80% of them you can just stop. They have no return on investment. So, and you'll see it as we go through, it requires you to have a dual view and always think when you're talking about something, am I talking about a constraint or a non-constraint? Not at all the same thing. Okay? And the other horror is the sum of local optimums is not equal to the global optimum. That is to say, what is the point in asking these people to work all the time? What is the point in asking a non-constraint to work all the time?
A benefit for the boss of that area.
A business.
Yeah, they look busy, right? And what do? They start lots of new projects, right? If your proof of concept people have excess capacity, they're going to be proving the concept of lots of new projects and stuff, right? And then the testing department, 2 years down the line, it's the bottleneck, is just going to have pile of projects. Okay, and so measuring the efficiency of people, in most cases, is a bad idea. Full utilization of machines and people, according to the theory of constraints, is a bad idea. That one hurts, because suddenly you have to have different ways of talking to people with regards to it's not just keep busy. It's are you producing value for my company as a system? 8 times out of 10, you're actually forcing them to do something that is destructive to the value of the company. Starting a project too early here is increasing the queue in the system and making sure that the project's all going to get longer and slower, more multitasked. This is the production, not projects, this is production. I just want you to keep it in mind. If you apply those ideas to manufacturing, such as in the goal, you have to identify the constraint. Sorry, this is making products from the raw materials to the finished goods. You have to identify the bottleneck, okay? Once you identify the bottleneck, that is what controls what the company can do, okay? So that will be giving the rhythm, and it's called the drum. It tells you what the whole system can do. The rope is just to stop people working too much and overactivating, because if they work according to their capacity, right, it's just going to pile up in front of the bottleneck. So the rope is, since I can only take care of that job on that date, don't start until that date. Okay, don't overfill the system in front of the bottleneck. Okay, that's the rope. And finally, the buffer is to make sure that if these people have problems, it will not stop the bottleneck. So you ensure that any work arrives in front of the bottleneck or the constraint a little bit before it's needed, so 2-3 days, 3 weeks, depending on the kind of business. Okay, and it's easier to understand in this way here to the now, and then we'll use the same idea in project management. Okay, but here because it's more repetitive, it makes more sense. The process of ongoing improvement, the strategy of improvement, or the theory of constraint. One, identify the constraint. And you are right, in projects it's more difficult to do than in the manufacturing world. We will talk about it. Decide how to exploit the constraint. Watch out, there are two steps that look the same. Exploit step 2 and elevate step 4. Exploit is what you can do without wasting time or money. Once I've identified it, what can I do right away just by changing management decisions or whatever? It's not. I found it. Let's see if I can make it produce more. What does it need and stuff? Sometimes it's very silly, like, you know, they need a new photocopying machine or they need a new something or other. You'll see examples. Okay? So that's what I can do immediately. Subordinate is the rope. Okay? Once we've identified it, you have to make sure that nobody else is working more than the constraint can, right? It's this rope system to stop that filling up, right? If I decide what I'm going to do here, all that has to be subordinated to what's going on here. I do not give these people work according to their capacity, but only according to what the system can do. Elevate the constraint is if you've got through these, you can then start spending time and money getting more out of the constraint. Okay, and if you continue doing that, you might break that constraint, as you say, get more and more and more out of it so the constraint is moved somewhere else. Okay, in that case, you find a new constraint and you start again. Okay, that is what I just described is the traditional orthodox way of talking about the theory of constraints. If I won't have time to really go into it because it's today in a one-day course, but personally, because this is a Marris consulting point of view, we believe that rather than going through bottleneck hunting, you should ask yourself, where is the best constraint in my company? If we accept that you cannot balance the system anymore, why not decide once and for all where you want your constraint to be? At least you'll know where it is and choose it, and there are rules for choosing it. Okay? But that's our point of view, not the traditional theory of constraints.